Hello and welcome to Simplifi TV, the web series and podcast for agencies, marketers, media buyers, and business owners. I'm David McBee. Our guest today is Doug Powell, an independent consultant who handles digital marketing at Boston Children's Hospital. Doug is, in his own words, an advertising dinosaur and a digital Neanderthal with over 40 years of experience. He was a very early practitioner of online marketing, and in fact, Doug was part of the team who executed the first paid online program with ESPN on behalf of the Levi Jeans Company. Currently, Doug works with the great folks doing miraculous things at Boston Children's Hospital. And in his free time, Doug teaches part-time at the University of Kentucky. Doug, welcome to Simplifi TV.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
Doug, let's just start this interview by addressing the elephant in the room. There are a lot of HIPAA laws and limitations on privacy for medical facilities. So, you know, what kind of audience targeting and digital strategies can medical facilities use while staying compliant?
First of all, I need to sort of caveat. My relationship with Boston Children's Hospital has somewhat of a narrow scope. And just the way that they're constructed, I have visibility into a lot about what they do, but not everything regarding what they do. So that said, one of the big things, and I've been working with them for 5 years, one of the biggest priorities they had and why I actually liked them so much was they have a big respect for all the HIPAA issues as it pertains to marketing. So I feel like that they were kind of front and center of taking some leadership on making sure that privacy was a big part of everything that at least I was involved with them. So I think of it more about compassion versus compliance, if that makes sense. Being very target centric, especially when your target is parents with children that have complicated health issues. So I think that one of the things that that has helped us from a focus standpoint is that we start from a place of what if we have to sort of target without a lot of the technicians that are involved with the sort of marketing platforms. And that's forced us to be a little more creative. I think it's also helped them become more of a test and learn environment where we've taken small steps. We like knowing what's out there, but we like to sort of like ease into things and see what happens. So I think that that's at least gives you kind of an overview of my involvement with them and then how we've approached the digital landscape, knowing that there's always these HIPAA complications and problems. And we're well aware of them. There have been lots of lawsuits that have been happening of late, and the entire hospital is very, walks on glass a little bit when it comes to regulation. So it's always front and center in everything that we do. And in fact, this past year, we actually stopped retargeting as a proactive measure of just making sure that we were in full compliance. And there was no concern, at least from internally, that we were doing something that might violate privacy.
So then what are some of the digital tactics that you leverage that that fall within the lines of privacy and HIPAA rules?
I'll start with one of the big test and learn things that we did early on was we thought that health environment was going to be one of the kind of a slam dunk for us. And so at the time, the ad director that was at Boston Children's had said, felt that in fact, lifestyle probably may be a better environment for us. So we did a lot of testing and learning and discovered that actually lifestyle focus, our environments that we'd want to be in, actually performed really well, both top of funnel and mid funnel, and really directed us in a whole new way. And so lifestyle and mindset became a big part of how we started to think about our target. So that gave us some guidance into the tools and things that we could use that we felt at least environmentally worked well for kind of getting us the prospects that we wanted. And just to sort of put a sort of another caveat here, a lot of what we do is awareness generation. We don't do a lot of heavy lifting, or at least I'm not a part of a lot of heavy lifting that they do in mid to low funnel. So
for those who are listening who may not be familiar with lifestyle targeting, could you describe that?
Oh, sure. Anything pertaining to what I like and enjoy doing. So cooking, vacations, decor, anything pertaining to sort of that lifestyle of a parent. So, which makes sense if you stop and think about it, because we are human beings first and foremost, and our message was very emotional. And so it sort of naturally lent itself to being, I think, more part of lifestyle than just serious health environments that we were in.
So this might be a challenging question to answer, but how do you prove the value of what you're running? Like you said, you did some testing and you found that it worked. What do you describe worked? What does that mean exactly?
Worked means that we saw engagement, both top kind of within the media format, as well as within the landing page. And also the hospital does a lot of brand tracking. So we were measuring kind of what the lift of awareness was going on and attitudes about the hospital. So we've been running our national campaign for almost 5 years, and it has consistently done very well on sort of all the metrics. And we've optimized extensively over time. And that's been helpful because as they develop other programs, we have a baseline of things that we know that work. So we're not starting from ground zero many times with some of the campaigns that they do.
Are you running mostly display ads, or do you run video or streaming television ads?
We very early were testing all those formats, and what we discovered, and not just within our branding effort, but in other campaigns they run, video is a slam dunk. Video, because we have an emotional story, and health, especially of children, is an emotional topic. Video does gangbusters. So we have more and more incorporated video in everything that we've done. So it's a winner, and in lots of different messages that they've actually done.
Excellent. All right. So what am I not asking? What do medical facilities really need to know as they charge into the digital landscape?
Many times it's like, what does the ecosystem look like? So the medical community is just now starting to take bigger strides and steps into marketing overall. And I think there's a big learning curve that they're going through in terms of what the digital landscape is going on. I've spent a lot of my time with the Boston Children's folks doing a lot of education work. So that's, I think, if you were to say what inning, you know, is the medical and healthcare profession in relation to, you know, sophistication of digital development, I'd say maybe third, fourth inning. There's still a lot that they have to be very careful. So they're still learning a lot, I'm still learning a lot with them.
So I imagine 5 years and a lot of lessons have come and gone. Is there anything that you would recommend medical facilities do not do in the digital space?
I think do not assume that it will work because it should work from a medical perspective. I think all options should go off the table. I think that was what drove us to some early successes is, again, back to we assumed that health environments or medical environments would be the appropriate place to be. And what we discovered was something completely different. So I would say challenge assumptions, because I think there's a lot that people have going in. And in fact, when I meet with doctors, which isn't frequently, they have a sort of predisposed notion of like what marketing should do and how it looks and what it should, you know, what it should be. So many times we have to sort of get them to step back and have an open mind.
I love that advice. That's really good.
Well, the other thing too, I have advice for anybody that's working with a healthcare provider, is that nothing moves quickly in a hospital or in an environment. Usually with any vendor that I've actually had to work with, that's one of the first sort of training things, is to say, you're used to working at light speed, and that's not how things operate. I mean, just getting approvals takes, we have to go through legal, we have to go through financials, it has to go through all kinds of approvals before literally getting an IO approved. So as quick as they move from a health maintenance and protection perspective, they move equally as slow from a sort of operations perspective. So, and understandable, they're very cautious. That's the culture that you have to work with. So,
but it sounds like once you get in the door and start proving things work, they stick around for a while.
Yes. And I longevity with them has been an interesting thing, just because we started very small and had some wins and proved success within the marketing arena. And that has helped grow and expand not only the practice of marketing, but how much they've invested over the 5 years that I've worked with them. So,
awesome. All right. Well, this has been amazing. Great content. I really appreciate you sharing your wisdom. Before I let you go, do you have a favorite podcast or a book that you feel has been instrumental in your success?
I love this question, especially because this is a podcast. I have two podcasts that will sound very off the wall, but if you stop, take a step back from what we do in the marketing area, our currency is ideas. And so what I tend to listen to and be drawn to are things that help me become a better idea person, even at my Neanderthal stage of my career. And two that I listen to, one is called Daily Intuition. It's a lady, Susan Gorman, actually does intuitive coaching, and she has a really great podcast about sort of application of intuition and having people rethink it. And I'm a big believer that our intuition is a big part of how we should be and do make decisions within the business world. I wish we did more of it, actually. And then the other podcast that I listen to is Creative Codex. I don't know if you've heard of it or not, but it's a fellow that really, it sort of explores things around creativity and also features individuals who are known for their creativity. And this last series that he just did was on Alexander McQueen, which was an individual that's kind of redefined what the fashion industry was in the late 90s and early 2000s. So
those are a little different from what we usually hear. So I love that. Thank you for that. Yeah, and if someone wants to learn more about you or get in touch, what's the best way for them to do that?
LinkedIn. I that's where my focus is. That's where I do sort of keep my connections going. And it's, as an independent contractor, it's been a big part of how I've developed my business over time. So a big fan of LinkedIn, although I don't post a lot, I'm well connected. So.
All right. And we'll include a link to your LinkedIn in the show notes. Thank you so much for being my guest today.
My pleasure, David. Thank you.
And thank you all for watching Simplifi TV. Please help us out with a like, comment, share, or review, and be sure to follow or subscribe to be informed about new episodes. Simplifi TV is sponsored by Simplifi, helping you to maximize relevance and multiply results with our industry-leading media buying and workflow solutions. For more information, visit simpli.fi. Thanks for joining us today. I'm David McBee. Be awesome, and we'll see you next time.